Greetings, fellow Bible readers. Welcome to week 17 of our Bible read-through. This week, we're finishing out 2 Kings and heading into 1 Chronicles. And as we look at this part of God's Word, we see a striking contrast between the faithfulness of God and the faithlessness of man. And as we see that faithfulness of God especially, we see it manifest itself in two different ways. First, it can manifest itself in faithfulness to his gracious gospel promises. But second, we also see on display God's faithfulness to his promises of law to punish those who reject and turn away from him. So let's dive into the readings for each day of the week. On day one, as we look at 2 Kings chapters 16 and 17, we see Manasseh, we see King Ahaz in the southern kingdom of Judah and his rejection of God. And in the northern kingdom, we see finally the destruction and end of that northern kingdom. We see God's faithfulness to his promise all the way back from the book of Deuteronomy when he told the people of Israel that if they rejected him, that ultimately they would be removed from that land of the promise. And now that word is coming true. On day two, we take a look at chapters 18 and 19, the reign of Hezekiah. We see, again, God's faithfulness to his promises of grace and protection to those who hold on to him. Incidentally, if you're planning on a family vacation this summer and you don't have your plan set, you might want to include a trip to Chicago and swing past the university campus, the University of Chicago, because there on that campus is a little museum called the Oriental Institute, and that houses one of the best collections of ancient Near Eastern artifacts in North America. And in particular, I mention it today because one of the artifacts that they have, called Taylor's Prism or Sennacherib's Prism, actually records the military campaigns of Sennacherib, and it includes his account of the military campaign that's recorded here in these chapters of Scripture where he attacks Jerusalem. So an interesting artifact. There are also a number of other artifacts that they have from different periods, but especially a number from Assyrian history that might give you a little bit of a sense of the culture and mindset and philosophy of these people who played a rather major role in the end of the Northern Kingdom of Israel. Then on day three, we look at chapters 20 through 22, and in these chapters, we see King Manasseh, who becomes, in many ways, the ultimate expression of rejection of the Lord and his gracious promises. Manasseh not only kills one of his sons in the fire and worship to a false god, he also turns to the Assyrians as his source of help for the problems that he has in this life. And that's contrasted with his son Josiah, who becomes the last good king of Israel, and in many ways is an ultimate expression of faithfully clinging to God's promises. And we see that the Lord is faithful to his promises of grace to King Josiah. Then on day four, as we finish out the book of 2 Kings with chapters 23 through 25, you'll want to pay attention especially to the little note right at the end of the book about Jehoiachin being released and being taken care of in his captivity. And there's a little bit more going on than just simply a note about some political figure, but Jehoiachin, as one of the descendants of David, is actually in the line of the Savior. And so this is God preserving the line of the Savior for the future birth of Jesus. Then on day five, we head into 2 Chronicles, reading chapters 1 and 2. And in these two chapters, we get a very brief overview of all of the Old Testament history that we've been looking at so far in our readings together by way of genealogy, just simply mentioning the names of all these important people. And as you do this, you read through those names, just think about all the Bible stories we've read and how just the mention of those names brings to mind details of God's faithfulness and stories about that faithfulness. Then on day six, as we look at chapters 3, 4, and 5 of 1 Chronicles, you'll want to notice at the end of chapter 3 that the genealogy of David's descendants goes down past the exile. And that's significant because it helps us to date when the book of 1 Chronicles was written. It was written after the exile. And that helps us not only to understand the date of when this book is written, but it helps us to understand the purpose of all these genealogies here at the beginning. They are to help the exiled people of Israel who are just getting back into the promised land and perhaps still wonder if God is watching out for them, is caring for them, helps them to trace their connection back to that nation of the promise. Then finally, on day seven, we look at chapter 6 of 1 Chronicles, and you'll notice it's a chapter that devotes all of its time to a genealogy of those serving in the temple. And that helps us to highlight one of the major themes in the books of 1 and 2 Chronicles, and that is the importance of the temple. It's going to have a major impact on the history that's written and what is recorded in this history in the books of 1 and 2 Chronicles. Well, that's all for this week. We'll see you next week.